very much, Carl. That was interesting. Shall we move to Brian?
Good morning and greetings from Vancouver, this year's winner of the Stanley Cup. If you're a sports fan, you'll know what I'm referring to.
Wrong.
Honestly, that was the only way that I could actually come to Boston in the middle of the Stanley Cup playoffs by promising to say something like that in public. So now that I've got that off, we can actually move on to my presentation here. Just a quick outline. As my introduction, I'm probably just going to go back and just unpack the title of this particular session a little bit, just to clarify or put some context around things. I'll give a very quick overview of the Public Knowledge Project, do a very quick whirlwind tour, I hope, just of the open journal systems, just to show you the range and variety of types of publications that are using it and also the functionality that's there. But I'm hoping to be able to have a few minutes at the end just to talk about some of the trends that are certainly seem to be emerging from our experience with having an open source journal publishing platform out there. First of all, let's talk about free. You've heard about free beer, but if any of you have ever owned a puppy or a dog, you know that there are lots of free puppies out there, but there's a lot of care and feeding involved in them. And probably to think of free software in the same way as a free puppy is perhaps a more realistic way of dealing with it. And next, let's just a few little quick comments on open source software. And first of all, to be clear, we're talking about open source here, not open access, although in some ways that's irretrievably intertwined, particularly with the Public Knowledge Project and OJS. But primarily what I want to focus on today is just the fact that OJS is an open source software tool. Some of the other points have already been made. LAMP, here's the technical part of the talk. That's basically the other open source tools or foundations that a lot of open source projects are built on. And LAMP stands for Linux as an operating system, Apache as a web server, MySQL is the underlying database server, and probably most of this programming or scripting done either in Perl or PHP language. And probably hundreds of thousands of open source projects that are out there are based on that. OJS certainly is. We've already mentioned a little bit about open source licenses. OJS and the other PKP products are licensed as GPL open source products. Some people have actually described GPL as a viral open source license because there's a number of different licenses out there. Some of them allow you to pull software in and perhaps commercialize it or do different things. It's not possible to do that with software that's licensed as GPL. You really have to keep it as open source. But another key concept in a lot of open source projects is attribution. Even though the software is put out there and it's free and people are encouraged to use it, any open source developer also expects or wants to have some attribution for it. So, for example, you can't take it and rewrite or replace the name of those original developers with yours and claim that this is your particular piece of software. But perhaps the most important concept with open sourceware is the development of a community out there. And most successful open source projects aren't just dependent on the initial developers. In fact, they're dependent on the community of users out there that take up the software to, in fact, contribute back, whether it's a plugin or some code or a language translation or documentation or anything like that. Just this next little list here, I just went through as one of the ways to support the software development. We also host OJS journals at Simon Fraser University, where I'm based. And this is just a quick list of some of the scholarly societies that we're currently hosting. They're using OJS for publishing one or more journals. And it's an interesting range there, probably from some that you perhaps never heard of through to some very big ones like American Society for Microbiology. In fact, they're only hosting one journal with us, and it's a very specific one, where it's their more sort of teaching or student-oriented journal, where they decided they wanted to do two things. First of all, find a lower-cost platform for that, because they provide that journal as a service. And secondly, to experiment with open access publishing. So they went with OJS as a tool to do that. They still do all of their other journals with their conventional and traditional publishing methods. The others are probably a good cross-section of the types of societies currently using OJS. Open Medicine is probably a whole presentation in itself. It's basically a breakaway journal from the Canadian Medical Association when the editorial board there basically resigned en masse because of some concerns about interference in the editorial process and advertising revenue in the journal, and essentially went open access and used OJS to set a journal up that now sort of is fairly healthily flourishing. This is just a cutesy little graphic, again, going back and looking at some of the journal, commercial publishers or quasi-commercial publishers using OJS, and that just gives you an example of the range of them. Some of them you've probably never heard of. We only heard of them when we went out and discovered they were using OJS, but again, it shows that there's already a fair bit of uptake in even the commercial publishing sector for using open source tools like OJS. I'll just move on a little bit of background on the Public Knowledge Project. It's actually 13 years old now in 2011. It was originally created by Dr. John Walensky when he was still at University of British Columbia. He's now been at Stanford for several years, but is still very active in the project. His core intent there was really to, in a sense, take the ivory tower concept of academic institutions and make the research, the publishing, a lot of the information a lot more accessible and available to the general public. That quickly led into some software development research, and it was an interesting time in the early 2000s because, of course, that was a confluence with developments like the whole transition from print to electronic publishing and also the rise of the whole open access movement. And certainly OJS is in many ways bound up with both of those activities. It's a relatively small core team, and they're based at SFU Library where I work. But in addition, again, I'll keep emphasizing this over and over, the importance of the Public Knowledge Project is the support that comes from the community, particularly a lot of in-kind support. We're now seeing more and more plugins and other pieces of software that are contributed to help improve the software. And we're also very proud that probably right now there's OJS is available in about 30 different languages. It's probably the only Catalan language publishing tool that's out there in the world right now. And again, that reflects the strength of an open source approach to software development, where you have community participants actually contribute code. So again, the software needs to be internationalized to support different languages. However, we don't have to spend the time and effort doing those translations. They're provided from the community. There's a quick overview of just the PKP software that's currently available. We've certainly the flagship system is Open Journal Systems. But we've also developed something called Open Conference Systems, which takes the whole sort of peer review workflow and everything associated with OJS and repurposes it for conference purposes. The Open Harvester system is actually an OAI-compliant metadata harvester that would really allow you to take any OAI-compliant database or service like OJS, harvest maybe tens or hundreds of journals from that, and really provide a portal or a larger front end to them. And we've also got some software in development, something called Open Monograph Press, where again we're going to apply a lot of the same principles in terms of open source software to developing something to support scholarly monographs in particular. And because we've been around long enough, we've also got to start rewriting the underlying code structure for the software to continuously keep it current and improved and start using some more contemporary software tools. There's a graphic that shows just the journals using OJS by continent. That's already out of date. It's January 2010, but the main point that I want to put it up there for is if you look at the number of users that are in the developing world, probably over half of the OJS journals that we're aware of are located in places like Asia, South America, particularly in Africa. And again, it reflects probably the reality that in the developing world, a lot of the scholarly journals, publishers, academic institutions have not been well served by the more sort of commercial publishing entities. It's been very difficult for them to get their documents, their publications out there. A relatively easy to install, low cost open source alternative has really done a lot of wonders for them being able to expose and get their content out there in a much more available fashion. And this is a chart that, quite frankly, sometimes elates us but also scares us because it still hasn't started to sort of settle down a bit or flatline. And as of April 2011, we're able to track or count 9,000 OJS installations around the world. And that's probably a conservative figure because it's being open source software. We don't actually know how many different people are using it. But this is where we go out and just do various checks and gather some data, and provided there's at least some content that's available in that instance, we'll declare it a viable OJS installation or counting. Yes?
You know, my question about installation, does that actually mean a journal, or what, in this context, does that mean?
It could mean one journal, or it could mean many journals, because again, you can run many journals in one instance or installation of OJS. And actually, about 2 weeks ago, that figure went over 9,500, and probably by the end of the summer, we're estimating it's going to hit 10,000. And what that means, there's all sorts of other interesting questions that raises about, like, where the heck are all these journals coming from and what's going on with them. And I'll maybe get back to that a little bit later, because I think there is some interesting stuff there. One other thing I'll mention too is that there are other open source e-publishing systems out there. I just refer you to a study that's a few years old now that was done by Mark Sizek at Johns Hopkins that took four of the then current open source systems and did a very detailed comparative analysis of them. It's also a cautionary note because I think if you go back and check those four publishing systems, two of them, at least at their website level, seem to have gone dark in the last year or two, and that it's not clear that they're still actively developing or using the software. One of them also is much more a repository-based platform. But again, it gives a good example of the sorts of things you should be looking at and analyzing if you're going to select a system. And of course, in the last few years, what's also come along are the exact sort of systems or applications that the other panelists are talking about, where you see content management systems being repurposed as a journal publishing system. OJS is not built on top of the CMS. It's really a custom-developed package, which in that respect has probably got more in common with some of the vendors or some of the other systems that are available up in the exhibits area. I'm going to do a really quick sort of cycle through about 10, 15 slides now that will just give you an idea of just the range of extended journals using OJS and some of its features. First of all, the basic thing it provides is a publishing platform or a website that you can put your journal up and just make it available to whoever you want. It also really has all of the typical functionality to control user accounts, and that can range from the roles that you assign to editors or reviewers or authors, or if you even want to control the access to the journal in terms of individual readers having to register for it. It's got that whole entire sort of back sort of office workflow in terms of journal management associated with it, so it does submissions in all their great and glorious detail. It handles the whole peer review process in terms of maintaining your list of reviewers, sending out notifications, the back and forth. It handles the subsequent editing in terms of the copy editing and all of the layout and the sort of controller preparation. In other words, it probably does a lot of things that are comparable to most of the commercial packages that are out there. And of course, it gets you to the final stage of being able to publish that journal in an online mode. Now again, as I mentioned, a lot of the journals using OJS have also adopted an open access publishing mandate. Again, they vary quite a bit, and you can start to see there's a lot of different look and feel. Again, the advantage of an open source product is you can customize it if you want. You may not want to get too far down that path because that could raise issues when you subsequently have a new upgrade coming out. The other thing about OJS is that it also supports delayed open access. In fact, it really has a full subscription module in it. Very early on, the first releases of OJS were really intended as open access publications, and it became apparent that that was not necessarily going to be suitable for all journals out there. So, in fact, one of our earlier journals, in fact, helped develop the initial subscription module. So it does all the things you would expect in subscription management in terms of IP address control and so forth. And that's an example from Equinox, which is a London-based publisher that makes extensive use of OJS. As I already mentioned, there's up to about 30 different languages that are supported in OJS. You can publish a journal, in fact, in multiple languages if you so choose, and that's supportable. There's plugins we support that if you want to use advertising as a way to generate revenue from your journal, that's possible. Increasingly, we're looking at ways that we can tie it in and do other things. Again, the whole point of an open source type project is you don't reinvent the wheel if you can, in fact, find an existing open source or equivalent service or tool out there. What you want to focus on is making your software interoperable with those other products and tying them in. Again, in terms of even ones that are not necessarily open source, there's obviously need to be able to handle e-commerce applications, so we've had to extend the software to support those. Again, you probably saw lots of slides yesterday with Google Analytics charts in them. It's possible to pull those into an OJS journal if you want to do some tracking or analytics. Counter and Sushi stats, the more conventional sort of production-oriented or publishing journal use stats are also supported. And again, we've had to do a lot of work in terms of how you can export journal content articles into repositories like DSpace, into PubMed. So again, in terms of the NLM DTD, there is support for that in OJS. In fact, it was Open Medicine, and it really helped sort of take that to its full extent for us. And again, CrossRef. And if there's an existing service out there that we don't talk to, either we encourage the person that needs it to develop the code, or in fact, we'll develop if there's enough demand. And again, we'll tie into other services that are available out on the internet, like pay for print. Reading tools, if we'd only done this in the last year or two ago, we'd have probably called these Web 2.0 or the social net thing, because basically this is where we've also built in a lot of functionality that, in fact, tries to sort of take it beyond just the straight article and provide links out to related articles, references, or so forth, or ways just how to cite the item. And again, it talks to a lot of the common citation systems out there and so forth. Here's an example, too, and this is probably where you're going to see a lot of input coming from our user community, that we've always supported supplementary files that you can attach to an article, but now there's a lot of interest in attaching audio and video clips or MP3 files. So we have OJS users that are attaching an MP3 clip, for example, to an article. Again, you can incorporate slides into a particular article. Videos can be incorporated in there also. We've got a number of OJS users that really want to push the limit. They like OJS because of the basic sort of workflow in terms of journal production, but they're also talking about journals that basically are publishing articles that are websites. So how do you start to incorporate multimedia into a conventional journal? So there's a lot that we're going to see being pushed by our own use community. There's just an example of one OJS instance that probably, in fact, has about 20-odd journals embedded in that particular instance. How much time do I have left there?
I'm over. Zero time, but
okay, very quickly.
We're ahead.
We did a survey, actually John Walensky did a survey just over a year and a half ago of about 2,700 of the OJS journals out there, of which about almost 1,000 responded. And this produced some very interesting information about that OJS community, which I think would be of interest to you because it shows some very different community patterns out there. First of all, a large group of our actual OJS journals fall into a category that we've termed as sort of independent scholar publisher. These are journals that are not affiliated or being published by a commercial publisher or even by a scholarly society. Probably no surprise, over 83% of them had an open access policy as their publishing mandate, and in fact another 8% had a delayed open access. And a very interesting first copy cost of basically $188. And we just threw out the comparison there to, I think, an Arlen estimate of $1,784. And I know there are lots of other sort of first copy article costs out there that are probably higher than that. And you can probably, I think, realize that a lot of this does not reflect a lot of the do-it-yourself or in-kind costs that are really hidden in a lot of these OJS journals. But again, that's why it's a more cost-effective platform. If they're doing it themselves, they're not, in fact, paying a lot of people to do that. There have been a couple of surveys recently that have also showed just the number of libraries that are getting involved in journal hosting. And I'll be very clear how I'm using the term journal hosting, not journal publishing. But again, if you look at it, the 2008 survey of 80 ARL libraries, almost two-thirds of them were already hosting or planning to host journals. Similar results back in Canada just a year or so ago. And I think there's even an even more recent update of that ARL library that shows that those numbers have increased. So I guess my last slide here, and I'm great to already see the term ecosystem appearing, I think, in the first presentation. And I guess what I'd like to suggest is that we probably are now looking at a much more complex ecosystem in terms of scholarly publishing, and it's open source platforms like OJS and the others that are probably contributing to that. There's some new providers in terms of services out there, libraries, and some of you probably have opinions on whether that's a good or a bad concept. Also starting to see, at least with OJS, the appearance of what I'm calling commercial hosting services that are really targeted for journals. They're not really publishers in the conventional sense. They're really only offering the technical support and those sort of hosting capabilities for someone using software like OJS. It's already mentioned a lot more participants, certainly from the developing world. Again, it's services like Google Scholar that they rely on quite heavily once they've got a journal out there to expose it. The other thing we're seeing are a lot more student-based journals. And these, again, are graduate study journals or student journals or even undergrad journals. And there's an interesting concept if you think of developing sort of brand loyalty. Most of these grad students are likely to be future journal editors or certainly contributors to that. And they're already getting quite used to working with open source software like OJS. And more importantly, obviously nobody's going to buy a subscription to a grad student journal. They're publishing in an open access venue also. The independent scholar publishers, again, have already alluded to that, but perhaps it's worth suggesting that a journal is perhaps a better vehicle in terms of interdisciplinary work or international work for scholars that makes it much more viable for them to actually collaborate with other researchers than, say, the more traditional scholarly societies even that tend to have some geographic boundaries or restrictions on them possibly. The other key thing that we're certainly seeing, too, there are changing relationships and collaborations. There's not a lot, but there are journals using OJS that use it purely for their review submission processes, and in fact, they still get published by a conventional commercial publisher. We're also aware of one very, very large publisher that actually indirectly is sponsoring OJS workshops in another part of Asia because Again, they are aware that with other value-added products, they don't necessarily have to publish or even own the journal, provided they can have access to its metadata. So in some respects, to have journals using open source software out there that aren't costing them a dime to run, but that they can still harvest the metadata for it, makes for some very interesting relationships there. Open source, I was quite thrilled in some ways to walk through the exhibit area here and see announcements about open platforms, hear about vendors talking about exposing their APIs or application programming interfaces. So it's obviously that open source software is even having an impact on the commercial world. And again, open access, DOAJ recently suggested that 20% of all the articles now being published are being done so under an open access mode. We're already looking at 80% of articles published in OJS being open access. Considering that we're coming up to the 10th anniversary of the Budapest Declaration on open access, I suspect nobody really envisioned that to be like 20%. It might be interesting to speculate whether we're going to see that trend flip even further in the coming years and the implications that has for all types of publication. And of course, maybe to preempt some questions, how is all of this sustainable? And that's a fair question. Certainly from our perspective as a software development enterprise, we do think it's quite feasible and possible to continue to develop open source software and also make it sustainable. And I'll cut off there, as I know I'm a few minutes over. Thanks.
Thank you.